Welcome to this chat about inclusive education. Our goal during these chats is to introduce you to interesting people working in the inclusive education area across Canada. I'm Gordon Porter, the Director of Inclusive Education Canada, and my colleagues today are Diane Richler, who's the Chair of the Catalyst for Inclusive Education Initiative of Inclusion International. She's a former Executive Vice President of Inclusion Canada and has worked on policy for inclusive education on a global level. My other colleague is Jackie Speck, who's a professor of education at Western University in London. She's also the director of the Canadian Research Center on Inclusive Education and works with more than two dozen educational researchers on inclusion from across Canada. Our guest today is Liz Bale. Liz is an educator in Yellowknife, the Northwest Territories. She's been a teacher, a principal, a vice principal, a district coordinator and director of student services, and has worked in a number of projects promoting inclusion throughout the Northwest Territories. Liz, thank you for joining us today, and tell us a bit about yourself and how you come to be identified as one of the movers and shakers of inclusion in the Northwest Territories.
Thank you, Gordon. And first of all, I'd just like to make a land acknowledgement that I'm here on YK First Dene Nation in their traditional territory in Chief Dry Geese land. And I am so lucky to be able to work, play, and have my family here with me in Yellowknife, Northwest Territories. So as you said, Gordon, I moved to the North 34 years ago with the intention to kind of just, come for a while with my husband and then move forward. But in actual fact, here I am 34 years later. I love living in the North. I have two children and a grandchild. And I've worked with Yellowknife Catholic Schools for 34 years in all those different roles that you've named. And I've always had, I think, a passion for working with children with special needs. And I have really come to love in my work in the Northwest Territories, working with families from all different kinds of cultures. And my big passion, I think, is always working with teams of people to problem solve with the very basic question, what's best? What's best for this child? So that is the thing that defines me and all that I do.
So Yellowknife is a small city, but you have a truly multicultural population, do you not? People from all over Canada and all over the world, in fact?
Well, the territory's population is 44,000. In Yellowknife, it's 22,000. Half of the population lives here because it is a big service hub and it provides a lot of supports and services for people. And there's the territorial and federal government here, as well as different businesses like the mines and things like that. And I think that, the thing about the territories is that we do have a large portion, mostly Indigenous, but we are seeing, with the onslaught of immigration, more refugees coming in and more families coming from actually not just across Canada, but all over the world to work and to locate here, because there's lots of opportunity. And you can now, pretty well have, a majority of the basic services here.
So tell us about inclusive education in Yellowknife Catholic Schools. What's been the history of it and what's your role been in it?
Well, we were very lucky when the territorial government said that we could no longer have segregated classrooms and we moved into the model as a territory of full inclusion. And I actually was recruited as one of the very first program support teachers or specialty teachers that would work in supporting staff to implement full inclusion in our schools. And we were really lucky because we actually reached out to you, Gordon, and we also reached out to Ontario with the Woodstock model, which was a process of how to embrace inclusion in schools, where it was having support teachers, the problem-solving model, that it was a team approach, and that we really work closely with the family to design and see what was the best kind of programming. And we refused to do pullout. That was not an option in the early years. And I think that that was a very smart way of doing it, because we would never go back there or resort to that, because we just knew it wasn't an option. It wasn't a default when things got wrong or there was challenges. And it really forced us to be creative of how do we provide, you know, proper programming within the classroom.
You have a lot of turnover in staffing. Not all the teachers who come to the North stay 34 years. What kind of challenge has it been that you have young teachers coming in from all over the country with probably quite different sets of training and preparation for the schools that you have?
Yes, this is a very key issue that you point out. Teacher staff turnover is really quite high, mostly in the small communities. We experience it in Yellowknife, but not as much, because as we have found that as years progress, and as I said, there's more services and more accessibility to, you know, the various businesses that we can have in the North, that people decide to stay because we can have a basic, you know, life of basically everything. And then of course, you know, you can always order things online. So people feel that they can have a quality life here and they don't miss too much, as well as, you know, they're able to leave, you know, despite COVID, to go back and forth and visit family. But yes, this has been the part of the problem with teachers coming in, because what they have done is, we're a very small department of education, culture, and employment. And we depend on Alberta's curriculum and a little bit of our own curriculum, but we have not had our own full menu of territorial curriculum. And so we've had to grab from different places. So what teachers have tended to do is, if you're a teacher from Nova Scotia, you brought in the curriculum that you knew, which was from the, you know, the Department of Nova Scotia and their educational system. And the same thing with if you were from Quebec or Ontario. And what has happened is that we don't have standardization. We don't have people following a proper scope and sequence. And everyone is basically doing what they think they should be doing based on what they bring to the territories. And the government is very hard now. And that's one thing that I always say as a PST, you know, lead and facilitator, is that we now, after so many years, 40 years, we have a standard of practice in how we approach children who require, you know, different kinds of supports and are diverse in their learning. And we have a very clear vision of what inclusion is, what programming look like, and that, you know, if you resort to other models across Canada, that's a loss and an erosion of what we're trying to build and know, which is good for our children in the Northwest Territories. Because I do believe, Gordon, that our model of inclusion has been extremely powerful based on the lack of service provision, the lack of accessibility to specialists. And I think, you know, some of the, you know, as I think the report that came out just recently from Raising Canada's Children, we have lots of challenges in the North. So it's very important that we know exactly what and how we're doing things to best make them feel that they can accomplish things.
Diane or Jackie?
Yeah. Can you talk a little bit about how you maintain an inclusive approach, thinking about the different risks that some of your learners have? You know, disability is one of the issues that you face. There was just a recent publication in Canada which identifies a lot of the violence that occurs in schools in the north. You talked about the fact that you have people now from different cultures and different backgrounds, new immigrants or people who don't have a history in the north coming in. How does your approach to inclusion deal with all of those issues? And is there a difference between your approach to including kids who have disabilities and the way you're dealing with some of these other challenges?
Well, I think that, first of all, we have a collaborative model, and that we say to teachers and we say to families, we never work alone. And that while we lack some of the services and we are faced with especially trauma and you know, families that have had intergenerational trauma, and the fact that we have language barriers, that we really believe that we need to gather as much information that we have on hand about the child, and that we will have the teacher and what we call the program support teacher work together to design what is best for that child. And it's always strength-based. We know that the child
who's the program support teacher?
Oh, sorry. The program support teacher is every school across the territories has in their school a designated teacher that has the specialty and the training to support teachers and principals and families and classroom assistants or educational assistants to design the appropriate programming as the child learns in the classroom and throughout their subject areas. And that's all they do. They don't pull out children. Their whole role is to coordinate information and to design with that teacher universal strategies within the classroom that all kids can benefit with the child with special needs in mind, and then to look at different kinds of interventions, accommodations, and modifications that that teacher can do or that other people can help that child achieve with those kinds of supports. So it's an ongoing process, and we're always reviewing children. We're always looking at what they can do and bolstering that, because that is really where we know that children with special needs feel that they have student agency, that they have a sense of belonging, that they can contribute, and that they have an identity and a sense of community in, first of all, their individual classroom, and then within the school themselves. So it's quite a complex and coordinated process, but we have mechanisms in the schools where there's that one program support teacher is doing class-wide reviews. They're pulling the teachers for half day. And one of the big initiatives that I've done over the last 3 years is that teachers need time. They need planning time. They need to sit with people who can give them the information they need to take the risks, to say, how do I reach these diverse learners? Let's start small and build upon it. And we have to let go of the fact that we are not going to be able to accomplish everything, but if we focus on their capabilities and strengthen that and go dive deep within that, and all students in the classroom are working in the same conjunction of that, it works.
And how are those teachers trained and supported?
Well, one of the fortunate things that we have that's very specific to the territories is because of a lot of the, the fact that our curriculum is not 100% complete, that we're dependent on Alberta, and that we do not have specialists readily accessible, is we provide in the territories caliber professional development. We have STIP time where teachers have planning days, and we are able, even though we're human resource poor, we do have the funds to access people of high caliber. And that's what superintendents have done. They've been able to give PD, send people off to PD. And I think it really becomes important to understand that we have to provide leadership skills in teachers, as well as, you know, the curriculum skills, that they have license and leadership to be able to have innovative ideas and creative ways to, you know, work with children of diverse profiles.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting, Liz, because, you know, really what you're describing is, it is the responsibility of the classroom teacher to teach all of their students. And there aren't all of these extra folk that are going to come and do that for you, which is, unfortunately, I think what happens in a lot of the bigger centers with lots of resources, we really tend to silo what that classroom teacher feels responsible for. So I'm just wondering, I mean, if you were to give some advice to the bigger centers in Canada, you know, what could we be doing differently?
I think that, you know, educators are really seeing, you know, the change in how we are understanding learning. And it is about the fact that we know that learning is, and what self-determination, student agency is that we have to help children understand how they feel about their learning. It is not so much about what they learn, it's how they feel about their learning, that it is so individualistic. And that they need to know as children in the 21st century and in the future, that, you know, they can influence, they have influence in their lives, in what they choose, in what they want to know, and in what they want to do. And that's the lens that we have as educators need to really have, is how do we make children feel? And because we can no longer give it to them, we have to empower them to know that they can self-determine what they want to do in life. And it doesn't matter what they don't have, it's what they do have. And I think also too is that gone are the days of colonial learning. It is about personalized educational learning. And what is an IEP? What is the individual educational plan? It is about personal learning. It is about what that one child needs to do according to their strengths and their ability, not their disability. And we have to really help teachers understand that really all children in every classroom is on their own personal learning journey. And we need to rethink that. And we're working on innovative design. We're trying to give a lot of choice and voice to children and what they want to learn and what they're passionate about. And to also say to teachers is that we have to create environments in the classroom that allow, especially our Indigenous populations of children and youth, see what they can do according to their identity and to their traditional knowledges and who they are, and, you know, be strength-based. And I think that, you know, that's starting to reach out, because I can tell you, we are not going to have enough speech language pathologists, occupational therapists, behavior specialists, and other people to be there for every child. This is what we're experiencing in the North. And as much as that's scary, I know that with the will and the passion of a team approach, of teachers helping teachers, it goes back to what Gordon said years ago, teachers helping teachers and figuring out who we can bring into the circle to go the next step with kids is the only way for inclusion. And it's for all children.
Liz, I'm a little curious about the Aboriginal element of the student population. Is it over 50% in the territory?
It depends. In the smaller communities, of course, it's 100%. In our school district, it is about 48%.
Okay. So yeah, my question is about teachers. How have you addressed the issue of having teachers who come from the Aboriginal community of the North? To my knowledge, it's not great numbers. What's the state status of that now? And where do you see that going in the future?
Well, I think the territorial government has done an incredible job in the last few years of really supporting school districts and district educational authorities all across the Northwest Territories in that regard of, helping teachers from, different parts of Canada understand the importance of Indigenous education and Indigenizing education. We have really come almost leaps and bounds in the last 2 years. And we're seeing the actual effects of, the hard start that we had in terms of trying to help expose teachers, to the ways of knowing, to the principles of Indigenous education, and the importance of providing all children to be on the land, to start to learn Indigenous languages again, to understand the importance of elders in the ways of knowing. Because also, the ways of the elders is so tied to the fundamental beliefs of inclusion. Mm-hmm. It's so tied to the ways in terms of story, in terms of belonging, in terms of identity and the value of family and, being able to be open to everything and not close mindset. This is so tied to that. And we also too have had more staff and personnel. We have, Indigenous learning educators. We have regional Indigenous educators that train our staff. And we are required more and more to take our kids out on the land and expose them to fishing, to trapping, to berry picking, all children. And so this helps us appreciate. And then of course, it also is around social justice and, the innovation of traditional ways, the contemporary ways. And I think that this is so important for us as, people who've come into the North, that we really understand our responsibility for truth and reconciliation. Because there's so much we don't know. As a settler here, there's so much I don't know, but I believe that the way that we're starting to embrace it in our school system and train our teachers and give them opportunity to really reflect, that we should never assume that we know how to work with Indigenous children. We need to help them self-determine and self-advocate what they want to learn and bring forward in their understanding of day-to-day life.
Can I switch gears for a second? Because I know one of the things that you've also worked on is early childhood education. Can you talk a little bit about that, both in the context of the North, but also in the context of inclusion?
This is a very important piece for us because, as you know, Diane, we are also seeing increasing numbers of children being identified with autism, with severe speech delays, with developmental delay, and with mental health concerns. and actually the inability to regulate themselves, high anxiety. And the territorial government just mandated junior kindergarten 2 years ago. We never had four-year-old schooling in the territories. It was really up to daycare providers. And in my school district, we actually had 16 years ago through CAPC and Health Canada, what we called the 4+ program, which really supported families because they couldn't even actually access day homes without having a one-to-one worker with them, and they had to pay or find someone to work with their child in the daycare. So we got funding to have a specialized program that would be a wraparound approach, and we actually had a junior kindergarten in our school system specifically just for families with special needs so that they didn't have to be denied daycare or play school. And we had that program for 16 years before they mandated JK. We have worked closely with the Stanton Hospital, the child development coordinator, and even though it's not completely formalized in the territories, the Stanton Hospital has a team of speech paths, OTs, and pediatricians that work with the different schools. And we have meetings. I was just actually in a meeting yesterday where we bring the family of four-year-olds and three-year-olds, and we sit with the family. And in that meeting is the rehab specialist, and then myself as a regional inclusive school, inclusive schooling coordinator, and the principal and the program support teacher to talk about how do we transition this child into our school smoothly. And that has really paid off and really supported the schools to be prepared. So now by April, I pretty well know the young children coming in, the four-year-olds coming in, and what I need to advocate for or plan for budget-wise in terms of classroom assistance, or if I need to work with, hearing impaired specialists or a behaviorist or an autism consultant, and to start making that connections for the families right away. But I am concerned that there's so many more kids and families we're missing, that they are, because as there's not a navigational system for families in terms of their children being identified that and with potential special needs. So often the schools are the first entry point for families, and we have to say to the families, we think your child needs these kinds of assessments because they're not able to, do this or do that, and we can help you with that journey.
And so, but this still is only happening at the JK level, so not before that.
Not before that. Some families are able to access it with the Stanton Hospital through pediatrician visits. But if the child and the family do not see a doctor or do not get identified through public health, then they basically won't have any supports until they come to school and we see that they have not yet been identified with needing help.
We're running down on time. Mm-hmm. Try to keep our chats to a half hour or so, Liz. But I'm wondering if Jackie, any final question or comment
you I guess have just,
about inclusion in the North?
Yeah, just building on, what Diane was asking about early childhood. So, a lot of times we say that once children hit the school system, the family really isn't as invited or as welcomed as they might have been in the earlier before they got to school. Do you see that happening in your schools as well, that the families aren't as welcomed, or are they welcome, and how do you work with them then?
I think there's a couple of things. One is that we really invite families. And one of the things that I'm really strong about, and I think that our district has been highlighted as one of the leading districts in inclusive for many, many years, and I've had families say it time and time and time again to me, is that We really see how important that family piece is. And I know that there has been many times we have spent hours in meetings. And we always say to families, you know what? Do not worry about it. We're here. We will meet at 5. We will meet whenever we can. And we really try to schedule regular meetings. There are some families who, you know, coming to school is hard, especially the Indigenous population and, you know, people who are working 3 or 4 jobs and they just can't come. And we see that a lot in the North. So what we try to do is we can do home visits, but I must say, you know, there's times where we find it difficult to reach families. But through Jordan's principle, what we have done is we've been able to access funding, especially for our Indigenous families, to have a community liaison officer who helps, you know, facilitate those meetings, that maybe looks at the basic needs first, constantly talking to the, you know, to the parents on the phone, reassuring them, answering any questions they may have about supports or what the teacher is saying to them. So we have a community family liaison officer that has really helped and made a difference and has been a bridge and a link to that formal setting. But I think our principals and our program support teachers really see that that is so critical to everything, is that outreach and really taking the time. And what we often do is when we have specialists come in for autism or for CNIB or whatever, or an ed psychologist, we always say to the parents, we're going to give you an extra hour or half an hour, and we're going to walk away. We're not going to be at the table. Whatever you need as a parent, or if you want to have them come to your house, we're willing to support you in that financially or to coordinate it for you.
Okay, with that, we're going to have to wrap up. I think we can all say that the Northwest Territories is well-placed when they have leaders like you to work on it. And I think for me, the most positive thing is that you've demonstrated in your comments that the work goes on. Like there's not, your schools are inclusive, but you're constantly working to improve your practices and do things more effectively for the children and teachers that need to be successful. So thank you, Liz. And I want to remind people that Liz has contributed to our work. And there's an article on sharpening the focus on inclusion in the North on our Inclusive Education Canada website. If people go there and search out Liz's name, you'll find that article. And a final word, Liz, before we say goodbye.
Well, I just wanted to say is around families is that I just gave 2-day presentation and trained all the territorial risks on person-centered planning and about families. And really that mapping and the things that, you know, Judith and Jack Pierpoint did years ago, it's been the diamond for us in the territories to once again, really that process of including families has really led the way for all our IEPs. And basically, you know, to say to families, we presume competence in every child. We presume that your child has ability. That's the disability piece is nothing that we are defined by us. It is what we do together. We're plugging away in the North.
Your enthusiasm is engaging. Thank you.
Yes. Take care. It's so nice to meet you all. And thank you so much. And Gordon, it's only minus 22 here instead of last week, minus 46.
And you have any sunlight?
Lots of sunlight now.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thanks again.